R1 prime minus half Laplacian rho R1 prime dr1 prime plus rho of R1 V of R1 dr1. So if you want to write more formally, then this is what is written actually. And so you can see that if you want to write formally, you require actually an orthogonal formula, which is eventually in DFT they will try to say that R1 is equal to R1 prime. Otherwise, I don't get electron density. And this is basically a density matrix here, as you can see, because you already have R1, R1 prime. This one you can straight away write, because it's a local function of R. So I can straight away write without R1, R1 prime in terms of this. Similarly, if I write the second term, so this is plus now, the second, last term, you can see again in the same way, I can now write this as integral rho 2 R1 R2, 1 by R1 dr1 dr. I hope you can see this quite trivially, because you have NC2, 1 by R1 2 term, 1 by Rij term. For each one, I do psi star psi. NC2 times will give me rho 2. Right? I just now define my gamma 2. Similarly, gamma 2 will be exactly like gamma n minus 2. NC2, but integration will be over all n minus 2 variables. So rho 2 times 1 by R1 2, dr1 dr. So you can see now there are two important parts. This is formally exact. What is important first to understand that even for energy, I do not need more than gamma 2. I don't need gamma 3, gamma 4, or rho 3. Please remember, gamma and rho are interconnected. Just spin has to be integrated. So if I know only 1 and 2 electron density matrix, or densities, the entire problem is over. This is exact. But this is not density functional theory. Why is it not density functional theory? For quite obviously, one reason is we have used R1, R1 prime here. That's not density. Density is only diagonal part. Second is you have two particle density, which is not electron density. So now both of them, I have a problem. However, as we are discussing, the Coulomb part, this has a Coulomb in the exchange part. We'll see that later. Coulomb part, you can write in terms of density, not the exchange part. This I will show a little later when I do the RT part for this part. Okay? But in principle, I can't write it in terms of density. However, if I use an orthogonal part of electron density matrix, one electron density matrix, and a two electron density diagonal part, I can write it exactly. Now, this gives a little hope. One is that when I did psi h psi, it appeared that I need too much of information, because psi has 4n variables. N number of electrons, each one has 4 variables. You can now see number of variables are reduced, because I need only rho 1 and rho 2. I'm calling it rho, but it can be called rho 1. I need only rho 1 and rho 2, and not all 4n variables. So this is the first very important part to understand, that energy does not require as much information as wave function contains. Wave function contains too much information. So the density matrix theory first gave a hope. Of course, this is not DFT. But I think people got an idea that can I simplify further? When the idea was there, even during the time Slater was working, because Slater, for homogeneous electron gas, had a very simple form for this in terms of rho to the power 5 by 2. That was the kinetic energy formula for Slater. If you remember, the entire thing was some constant times integral rho to the power 5 by 3 r dr. So Slater already was talking, but this was good for homogeneous electron gas, which should never work. So the people were already thinking of simplifying this energy expression, because this was too big, because I required too many information inside. The important part is that you may now say, okay, let me do a variational calculation with only, not varying psi, but varying only rho and rho 2. So this is a good starting point. You may say, this is exact. So I'm going to vary only rho and rho 2. that variation would be much less than the variation of entire space of sight. But then there is a real problem. The problem is that rho 1 and rho 2 are connected. So that is first, because rho 1 must be derived from rho 2. Second, although I don't have rho 3, rho 4, etc. up to rho n, I know they formally exist, and these connections also should be established. So if I have only rho 1 and rho 2, how do I know that I can get rho 3 consistently? So this was a very important problem. Then they said, okay, put constraints. Rho 3 should be derived from rho 2. Rho 4 should be derived from rho 3. Then you have the full problem. So I can vary this energy expression. So vary this, and then say, put a constraint that rho 2 is derived from rho 1. Okay? Rho 3 is derived from rho 2, and so on. It is reverse. Rho 1 is derived from rho 2. Rho 2 is derived from rho 3, and so on. If you do this, constraint conditions, subject to these conditions, you are actually again solving the full problem. Okay? Without these, what is called n representability cannot be satisfied. So this was a very famous problem in density metrics, that really have I solved the problem? No. Because finally, these rows and row 2s are connected to psi. So unless I have an entire chain of constraints, I'm not sure what my variation is giving me. It's giving me a psi which may not be the right psi. Psi which is hidden in row 1 and row 2. Psi not explicit. So that means essentially a row 1 and row 2 constructed from a wrong psi, which is non-n representative. Not n representative. So this was a very serious problem in the early days, and this is actually still a burning problem in terms of density metrics theory. But in principle, people looked at variation of this, and what was interesting is that my energy expression does not require rho 3, rho 4, up to rho n. It only stops at rho 2. Why does it happen? The core problem is, core issue is that the Hamiltonian has only one and two electrons. So that is the important. If the Hamiltonian had a three electron pair, four electron pair, which is not just a Coulomb, then of course you would have higher densities. The densities are lower densities are coming because of the specific form of the Hamiltonian. And that's the reason I am only getting up to two electron density, formally. But it is only formal because I still have to connect all of them to the n particle side. So this condition is a very difficult condition to fulfill. Using these, of course, I can first rewrite Hartree form. Assume that psi is a single determinant, I can rewrite Hartree form. In fact, that is very easy to do. So let me write down the Hartree form density. So let's say that I have a single particle density, single particle vector wave function. So what will be my rho 1 first? Let me write it down. So I have to do this psi star psi over all the n minus 1 variables. I would write down the final results without proof. So the density rho of r prime r, because I require the up diagonal part. So I'm writing r prime r, and you can write it r1 prime r1, is equal to sum over all the spin orbitals, phi I star r1 prime, or the spatial orbitals. If it is a restricted Hartree form, multiply by 2. So these phis are now special orbitals. So I am now specifically writing for a restricted Hartree form determinant, which means it's a closed shell determinant that we explained, two electrons in one pair of space orbitals. So number of space orbitals will be how many? 1, 2, n by 2, right? Because half of the special orbitals is there for given n electron. Each of them has two electrons. So I can write this actually is a very trivial integration. Psi star psi, if it is single determinant, you can see that only this will survive. This is exactly what is called orbital densities. So diagonal part of these are basically nothing but sum of orbital densities. So single determinant has a very simple picture. Just take each orbital, take its density, multiply sum. Okay? If you write in terms of spin orbitals, this factor 2 is not required, then they will become chi I star chi I. some will be over 1:2. But that's a trivial problem. I'm looking at a simple problem of RHF, let's say. So rho can be easily written. Then what is rho 2? Now rho 2, let me first write down the matrix of rho. So rho 2 also has two sets of variables. I told you, prime and unprime. I wrote only the diagonal part. And that is all that is required, however. But let me first write the rho 2. Or you can, if you want, I can write the rho 2 directly in terms of rho 1. Only the diagonal part I can write. So basically, I remove this prime. So prime and unprime are same, in which case I have a simpler way of writing, just write rho 2 of R1, just like what I did. This can now be written as rho 1 R1, which is the density. Rho 1 R1 R2. Rho 1 R2 R1. Rho 1 R2. Note that these two are diagonal elements. So actually I can write R1 R1, R2 R2. Okay? And there is a factor 1 by 2 factor. So this is something I am not proving, but it's very easy to do. For a single determinant, one can actually do the expansion and write a two electron diagonal for rho 2 in terms of rho 1, matrix of rho 1. So this is basically, if I expand, this is the density, so it is R1, R1, this is R2, R2. But since they are diagonal parts, I can satisfy rho 1, R1. Rho 1, R2. This is actually an odd diagonal matrix, where one of the R1, R1 prime, one of them is R1, one of them is R2. And here is R2, R1. So even now, see, this is not the problem in stock. The rho 2 is actually written in terms of density. One electron density matrix. Note what I told you before. I told you that if I know rho 2, I can calculate rho 1. Remember, my psi has n particle density. By integration, I can go down. I cannot go up. So if I have given rho 2, I can write rho 1. But now, see what I have got for Hartree Fock. For a single determinant, I have actually got the reverse too. That given a rho 1, I am able to construct rho 2. So note what I said before. In general, if I have n particle density, by integration I can go down. Which means, given a rho 2, I can construct rho 1. However, for a single determinant, I am now able to show that given a rho 1, I am able to construct rho 2. Now, this is a very special property for single determinants. I again repeat, this is only for single determinants. The fact that the rho 1 can give you rho 2 is a very specific property of all single determinants. Of course, all single determinants, not just Hartree Fock. So, Hartree Fock in particular. And this is a very nice one. Then, if I now put this rho 2 here, I can actually write the Hartree Fock Coulomb and exchange. So, what is Hartree Fock? This is general. As soon as you replace rho 2 by this, it's a Hartree Fock. For one determinant. I mean, Hartree Fock is, of course, nothing special here. So, I don't have to worry about it. Moment I do this, you will immediately see that there will be two terms which will come by expanding the determinant. One is rho 1 into rho 2 minus rho 1 of diagonal terms. One two of R1 R2 times 1 by R1 2 dr1 dr2. So that's what I'm writing. The last part. So what do? I expand this. So first term is half integral rho 1 of R1. Rho 1 of R2, 1 by R1 to dr1 dr2. Note that I can write 1 by R1 to also here. It doesn't matter how I write it. They're just a multiplicative function. So that's the first term. Then you have the second term, minus, that is basically this term, minus half. Now you will see the problem. Rho 1 of R1 R2, rho 1 of R2 R1. 1 by R1 P, dr1 dr. Let's, for the time being, not worry about the kinetic energy function. But even in the two electron function, for Hartree form, I now have a problem. The Coulomb power, this is basically Coulomb. I hope all of you realize this Coulomb, because it's a density at R1, density at R2 interactive. That's a Coulomb. Phi star phi, phi j star phi j, interactive, right? So the Coulomb part can be written actually in terms of density. This part, if you expand in terms of orbitals, you immediately see this is the exchange. And now exchange requires the orthogonal part again. So that is what Sushant was mentioning, that the orthogonal part also is required even for Hartree form. So even if I have a trick to somehow expand this kinetic energy in terms of density, I still cannot have density functional even for Hartree form. Forget about correlation, that's the later part. Formally, even Hartree form theory cannot be represented in terms of density functional theory. Because I don't know how to represent the kinetic energy part, which I was going to come into later, and the Cohn and Schramm actually explained that later. And that's the reason I was avoiding the one electron part. Today, I wanted to discuss the two electron part. The two electron part, even for Hartree form, has orthogonal one particle density. And hence, if you want to write everything in terms of only rho of R, or rho 1 of R1, or R2, whatever, these are dummy variables, it's not possible. So, how does DFT work? So, that is the first thing that I want to first present, that density matrix, this is exact. Then, for restricted Hartree form, this is rho, or rho 1, you can call it rho 1. The rho 2 can be written in terms of rho 1. This is a very special property of only single determinant. I'm again not going to prove it, but it is very easy. Expand single determinant psi star psi and do all the calculations, you will actually get the determinant form. But what is important is that now I put this here, and I actually recover the Coulomb and the exchange form. So this is my J, this is my K, no problem. But then I immediately find that the K has an off-diagonal density. Whereas the Coulomb part is just density times density. So that is very easy. Is it clear? Okay, so this is where it stands, and this is the problem. Forget about correlation, that's the even better part. Because correlation will further refine the two electron density. In what way, I don't know. But at least it's good to know that I don't need rho 3, rho 4, rho 5, up to rho n in energy. Formally, I don't need. But I need to eventually see that they should be all connected. Because they are all derivable from one wave function. And this is a very difficult problem. In fact, Mel Levy, who has done a lot of work, has actually addressed this problem by Levy's constraint search method. You know, how do I ensure this? So those are, of course, very difficult parts of DFT, which is not mentioned. But then formally, I must say, how did DFT come? Because this is still not DFT. So why did you think of DFT? It came because of a very famous paper in 1964 by Weinberg and Cohn. He did not derive it. If he could derive, the problem would be over. But he simply said, and this is very famously known as HK theorem, Weinberg-Cohn theorem, and Walter Cohn, who got Nobel Prize, certainly got for this work, not alone, but along with probably the Cohn-Schramm kinetic energy. But certainly this is very important. Cohn-Schramm kinetic energy is something I will discuss. This part I will discuss tomorrow. Okay, how do you handle this?